In like manner, if the paths between M and the four other localities have been so slightly excavated by previous experience as to require a very intense excitement in either of the localities before M can be awakened, a less strong excitement than this in any one will fail to reach M. But if all four at once are mildly excited, their compound effect on M may be adequate to its full arousal. The psychological law of association of objects thought of through their previous contiguity in thought or experience would thus be in effect, within the mind, of the physical fact that nerve currents propagate themselves easiest through those tracts of conduction which have been already most in use. Descartes and Locke hit upon this explanation, which modern science has not yet succeeded in improving. Custom, says Locke, settles habits of thinking in the understanding, as well as of determining in the will, and of motions in the body, all which seem to be but trains of motion in the animal spirits which, once set a-going, continue in the same steps they have been used to, which by often treading are worn into a smooth path, and the motion in it becomes easy and, as it were, natural. Hartley was more thorough in his grasp of the principle. The sensorial nerve currents, produced when objects are fully present, were for him vibrations, and those which produce ideas of objects in their absence were miniature vibrations. And he sums up the cause of mental association in a single formula by saying, any vibrations, A, B, C, etc., by being associated together a sufficient number of times, get such a power over A, B, C, etc., the corresponding miniature vibrations, that any of the vibrations A, when impressed alone, shall be able to excite B, C, etc., the miniatures of the rest. It is evident that if there be any law of neural habit similar to this, the contiguities, coexistences, and successions, met with in outer experience, must inevitably be copied more or less perfectly in our thought. If A, B, C, D, E be a sequence of outer impressions, they may be events or they may be successively experienced properties of an object, which once gave rise to the successive ideas A, B, C, D, E, then no sooner will A impress us again and awaken the A, than B, C, D, E will arise as ideas even before B, C, D, E have come in as impressions. In other words, the order of impressions will the next time be anticipated, and the mental order will so far forth copy the order of the outer world. Any object when met again will make us expect its former concomitants, through the overflowing of its brain tract into the paths which lead to theirs. And all these suggestions will be effects of a material law. Where the associations are, as here, of successively appearing things, the distinction I made at the outset of the chapter, between a connection thought of and a connection of thoughts, is unimportant. For the connection thought of is concomitance or succession, and the connection between the thoughts is just the same. The objects and the ideas fit into parallel schemes, and may be described in identical language, as contiguous things tending to be thought again together, or contiguous ideas tending to recur together. Now were these cases fair samples of all association, the distinction I drew might well be termed a spitzfindigot or piece of pedantic hair-splitting, and be dropped. But as a matter of fact we cannot treat the subject so simply. The same outer object may suggest either of many realities formerly associated with it, for in the vicissitudes of our outer experience we are constantly liable to meet the same thing in the midst of different companions, and a philosophy of association that should merely say that it will suggest one of these, or even of that one of them which it has oftenest accompanied, would go but a very short way into the rationale of the subject. This, however, is about as far as most associationists have gone with their principle of contiguity. Granted an object, A, they never tell us beforehand which of its associates it will suggest, their wisdom is limited to showing, after it has suggested a second object, that that object was once an associate. They have had to supplement their principle of contiguity by other principles, such as those of similarity and contrast, before they could begin to do justice to the richness of the facts. The elementary law of association. I shall try to show, in the pages which immediately follow, that there is no other elementary causal law of association than the law of neural habit. All the materials of our thought are due to the way in which one elementary process of the cerebral hemispheres tends to excite whatever other elementary process it may have excited at some former time. The number of elementary processes at work, however, and the nature of those which at any time are fully effective in rousing the others, determine the character of the total brain action, and, as a consequence of this, they determine the object thought of at the time. According as this resultant object is one thing or another, we call it a product of association by contiguity or of association by similarity, or contrast, or whatever other sorts we may have recognized as ultimate. Its production, however, is, in each one of these cases, to be explained by a merely quantitative variation in the elementary brain processes momentarily at work under the law of habit, so that psychic contiguity, similarity, etc., are derivatives of a single profounder kind of fact. My thesis, stated thus briefly, will soon become more clear, and at the same time certain disturbing factors, which cooperate with the law of neural habit, will come to view. Let us then assume as the basis of all our subsequent reasoning this law, when two elementary brain processes have been active together or in immediate succession, one of them, on reoccurring, tends to propagate its excitement into the other. But, as a matter of fact, every elementary process has found itself at different times excited in conjunction with many other processes, and this by unavoidable outward causes. Which of these others it shall awaken now becomes a problem. Shall B or C be aroused next by the present A? We must make a further postulate, based, however, on the fact of tension in nerve tissue, and on the fact of summation of excitements, each incomplete or latent in itself, into an open resultant. The process B, rather than C, will awake, if in addition to the vibrating tract A some other tract D is in a state of subexcitement, and formerly was excited with B alone and not with A. In short, we may say, the amount of activity at any given point in the brain cortex is the sum of the tendencies of all other points to discharge into it, such tendencies being proportionate, 1, to the number of times the excitement of each other point may have accompanied that of the point in question. 2, to the intensity of such excitements. And, 3, to the absence of any rival point functionally disconnected with the first point, into which the discharges might be diverted. Expressing the fundamental law in this most complicated way leads to the greatest ultimate simplification. Let us, for the present, only treat of spontaneous trains of thought and ideation, such as occur in reverie or musing. The case of voluntary thinking toward a certain end shall come up later. Take, to fix our ideas, the two verses from Locksley Hall. I, the heir of all the ages in the foremost files of time, and for I doubt not through the ages one increasing purpose runs. Why is it that when we recite from memory one of these lines, and get as far as the ages, that portion of the other line which follows, and, so to speak, sprouts out of the ages, does not also sprout out of our memory, and confuse the sense of our words? Simply because the word that follows the ages has its brain process awakened not simply by the brain process of the ages alone, but by it plus the brain processes of all the words preceding the ages. The word ages at its moment of strongest activity would, per se, indifferently discharge into either in or one. So would the previous words, whose tension is momentarily much less strong than that of ages, each of them indifferently discharge into either of a large number of other words with which they have been at different times combined. But when the processes of I, the heir of all the ages, simultaneously vibrate in the brain, the last one of them in a maximal, the others in a fading phase of excitement, then the strongest line of discharge will be that which they all alike tend to take. In, and not one or any other word will be the next to awaken, for its brain process has previously vibrated in unison not only with that of ages, but with that of all those other words whose activity is dying away. It is a good case of the effectiveness overthought of what we called on page 258. A fringe. But if some one of these preceding words there, for example, had an intensely strong association with some brain tracts entirely disjoined in experience from the poem of Locksley Hall, if the reciter, for instance, were tremulously awaiting the opening of a wool which might make him a millionaire, it is probable that the path of discharge through the words of the poem would be suddenly interrupted at the word air. His emotional interest in that word would be such that its own special associations would prevail over the combined ones of the other words. He would, as we say, be abruptly reminded of his personal situation, and the poem would lapse altogether from his thoughts. The writer of these pages has every year to learn the names of a large number of students who sit in alphabetical order in a lecture room. He finally learns to call them by name, as they sit in their accustomed places. On meeting one in the street, however, early in the year, The face hardly ever recalls the name, but it may recall the place of its owner in the lecture room, his neighbor's faces, and consequently his general alphabetical position. And then, usually as the common associate of all these combined data, the student's name surges up in his mind. A father wishes to show to some guests the progress of his rather dull child in kindergarten instruction. Holding the knife upright on the table, he says, "What do you call that, my boy?" "I calls it a knife, I does," is the sturdy reply, from which the child cannot be induced to swerve by any alteration in the form of question, until the father, recollecting that in the kindergarten a pencil was used, and not a knife, draws a long one from his pocket, holds it in the same way, and then gets the wished-for answer, "I calls it vertical." All the concomitants of the kindergarten experience had to recombine their effect before the word vertical could be reawakened. Professor Bain, in his chapters on compound association, has treated in a minute and exhaustive way of this type of mental sequence, and what he has done so well need not be here repeated. Impartial redintegration. The ideal working of the law of compound association, were it unmodified by any extraneous influence, would be such as to keep the mind in a perpetual treadmill of concrete reminiscences from which no detail could be omitted. Suppose, for example, we begin by thinking of a certain dinner party. The only thing which all the components of the dinner party could combine to recall would be the first concrete occurrence which ensued upon it. All the details of this occurrence could in turn only combine to awaken the next following occurrence, and so on. If A, B, C, D, E, for instance, be the elementary nerve tracts excited by the last act of the dinner party, call this act A, and L, M, N, O, P, be those of walking home through the frosty night, which we may call B, then the thought of A must awaken that of B, because A, B, C, D, E will each and all discharge into L through the paths by which their original discharge took place. Similarly, they will discharge into M, N, O, and P, and these latter tracts will also each reinforce the other's action because, in the experience B, they have already vibrated in unison. The lines in Figure 40 symbolize the summation of discharges into each of the components of B, and the consequent strength of the combination of influences by which B in its totality is awakened. Hamilton first used the word redintegration to designate all association. Such processes as we have just described might in an emphatic sense be termed redintegrations, for they would necessarily lead, if unobstructed, to the reinstatement in thought of the entire content of large trains of past experience. From this complete redintegration there could be no escape save through the eruption of some new and strong present impression of the senses, or through the excessive tendency of some one of the elementary brain tracts to discharge independently into an aberrant quarter of the brain. Such was the tendency of the word air in the verse from Locksley Hall, which was our first example. How such tendencies are constituted we shall have soon to inquire with some care. Unless they are present, the panorama of the past, once opened, must unroll itself with fatal literality to the end, unless some outward sound, sight, or touch divert the current of thought. Let us call this process impartial redintegration. Whether it ever occurs in an absolutely complete form is doubtful. We all immediately recognize, however, that in some minds there is a much greater tendency than in others for the flow of thought to take this form. Those insufferably garrulous old women, those dry and fanciless beings who spare you no detail, however petty, of the facts they are recounting, and upon the thread of whose narrative all the irrelevant items cluster as pertinaciously as the essential ones, the slaves of literal fact, the stumblers over the smallest abrupt step in thought, are figures known to all of us. Comic literature has made her profit out of them. Juliet's nurse is a classical example. George Eliot's village characters and some of Dickens's minor personages supply excellent instances. Perhaps as successful a rendering as any of this mental type is the character of Miss Bates in Miss Austen's Emma. Hear how she redintegrates. "But where could you hear it?" cried Miss Bates. "Where could you possibly hear it, Mr. Knightley? For it is not 5 minutes since I received Mrs. Cole's note. No, it cannot be more than 5 or at least 10, for I had got my bonnet and spencer on, just ready to come out. I was only gone down to speak to Patty again about the pork. Jane was standing in the passage. Were not you, Jane, for my mother was so afraid that we had not any salting pan large enough. So I said, I would go down and see, and Jane said, shall I go down instead? For I think you have a little cold, and Patty has been washing the kitchen. Oh, my dear, said I, well, and just then came the note. A Miss Hawkins, that's all I know, a Miss Hawkins, of Bath. But, Mr. Knightley, how could you possibly have heard it? For the very moment Mr. Cole told Mrs. Cole of it, she sat down and wrote to me. A Miss Hawkins, but in every one of us there are moments when this complete reproduction of all the items of a past experience occurs. What are those moments? They are moments of emotional recall of the past as something which once was, but is gone forever, moments, the interest of which consists in the feeling that ourself was once other than it now is. When this is the case, any detail, however minute, which will make the past picture more complete, will also have its effect in swelling that total contrast between now and then which forms the central interest of our contemplation. Ordinary or mixed association. This case helps us to understand why it is that the ordinary spontaneous flow of our ideas does not follow the law of impartial redintegration. In no revival of a past experience are all the items of our thought equally operative in determining what the next thought shall be. Always some ingredient is prepotent over the rest. Its special suggestions or associations in this case will often be different from those which it has in common with the whole group of items, and its tendency to awaken these outlying associates will deflect the path of our reverie. Just as in the original sensible experience our attention focalized itself upon a few of the impressions of the scene before us, so here in the reproduction of those impressions an equal partiality is shown, and some items are emphasized above the rest. What these items shall be is, in most cases of spontaneous reverie, hard to determine beforehand. In subjective terms, we say that the prepotent items are those which appeal most to our interest. Expressed in brain terms, the law of interest will be, some one brain process is always prepotent above its concomitants in arousing action elsewhere. Two processes, says Mr. Hodgson, are constantly going on in redintegration. The one a process of corrosion, melting, decay, the other a process of renewing, arising, becoming. No object of representation remains long before consciousness in the same state, but fades, decays, and becomes indistinct. Those parts of the object, however, which possess an interest resist this tendency to gradual decay of the whole object. This inequality in the object, some parts, the uninteresting, submitting to decay, others, the interesting parts, resisting it when it has continued for a certain time, ends in becoming a new object. Only where the interest is diffused equally over all the parts, as in the emotional memory just referred to, where, as all past, they all interest us alike, is this law departed from. It will be least obeyed by those minds which have the smallest variety and intensity of interest, those who, by the general flatness and poverty of their aesthetic nature, are kept forever rotating among the literal sequences of their local and personal history. Most of us, however, are better organized than this, and our musings pursue an erratic course, swerving continually into some new direction traced by the shifting play of interest as it ever falls on some partial item in each complex representation that is evoked. Thus it so often comes about that we find ourselves thinking at two nearly adjacent moments of things separated by the whole diameter of space and time. Not till we carefully recall each step of our cogitation do we see how naturally we came by Hodgson's law to pass from one to the other. Thus, for instance, after looking at my clock just now, 1879, I found myself thinking of a recent resolution in the Senate about our legal tender notes. The clock called up the image of the man who had repaired its gong. He suggested the jeweler's shop where I had last seen him, that shop, some shirt studs which I had bought there, they, the value of gold and its recent decline, the latter, the equal value of greenbacks, and this, naturally, the question of how long they were to last, and of the Bayard proposition. Each of these images offered various points of interest. Those which formed the turning points of my thought are easily assigned. The gong was momentarily the most interesting part of the clock, because, from having begun with a beautiful tone, it had become discordant and aroused disappointment. But for this the clock might have suggested the friend who gave it to me, or any one of a thousand circumstances connected with clocks. The jeweler's shop suggested the studs, because they alone of all its contents were tinged with the egoistic interest of possession. This interest in the studs, their value, made me single out the material as its chief source, etc., to the end. Every reader who will arrest himself at any moment and say, "How came I to be thinking of just this?" will be sure to trace a train of representations linked together by lines of contiguity and points of interest inextricably combined. This is the ordinary process of the association of ideas as it spontaneously goes on in average minds. We may call it ordinary, or mixed, association. Another example of it is given by Hobbes in a passage which has been quoted so often as to be classical. In a discourse of our present civil war, what could seem more impertinent than to ask, as one did, what was the value of a Roman penny? Yet the coherence to me was manifest enough. For the thought of the war introduced the thought of the delivering up the king to his enemies, the thought of that brought in the thought of the delivering up of Christ, and that again the thought of the 30 pence, which was the price of that treason, and thence easily followed that malicious question, and all this in a moment of time, for thought is quick. Can we determine, now, when a certain portion of the going thought has, by dint of its interest, become so prepotent as to make its own exclusive associates the dominant features of the coming thought, can we, I say, determine which of its own associates shall be evoked? For they are many. As Hodgson says, the interesting parts of the decaying object are free to combine again with any objects or parts of objects with which at any time they have been combined before. All the former combinations of these parts may come back into consciousness, one must, but which will? Mr. Hodgson replies, there can be but one answer, that which has been most habitually combined with them before. This new object begins at once to form itself in consciousness, and to group its parts round the part still remaining from the former object. Part after part comes out and arranges itself in its old position. But scarcely has the process begun, when the original law of interest begins to operate on this new formation, seizes on the interesting parts and impresses them on the attention to the exclusion of the rest. And the whole process is repeated again with endless variety. I venture to propose this as a complete and true account of the whole process of redintegration. In restricting the discharge from the interesting item into that channel which is simply most habitual in the sense of most frequent, Hodgson's account is assuredly imperfect. An image by no means always revives its most frequent associate, although frequency is certainly one of the most potent determinants of revival. If I abruptly utter the word swallow, the reader, if by habit an ornithologist, will think of a bird; if a physiologist or a medical specialist in throat diseases, he will think of deglutition. If I say date, he will, if a fruit merchant or an Arabian traveler, think of the produce of the palm; if an habitual student of history, figures with AD or BC before them will rise in his mind. If I say bed, bath, morning, his own daily toilet will be invincibly suggested by the combined names of three of its habitual associates. But frequent lines of transition are often set at naught. The sight of C. Goring's System der Kritischen Philosophie has most frequently awakened in me thoughts of the opinions therein propounded. The idea of suicide has never been connected with the volumes. But a moment since, as my eye fell upon them, suicide was the thought that flashed into my mind. Why? Because but yesterday I received a letter from Leipzig informing me that this philosopher's recent death by drowning was an act of self-destruction. Thoughts tend, then, to awaken their most recent as well as their most habitual associates. This is a matter of notorious experience, too notorious, in fact, to need illustration. If we have seen our friend this morning, the mention of his name now recalls the circumstances of that interview, rather than any more remote details concerning him. If Shakespeare's plays are mentioned, and we were last night reading Richard II, vestiges of that play rather than of Hamlet or Othello float through our mind. Excitement of peculiar tracts, or peculiar modes of general excitement in the brain, leave a sort of tenderness or exalted sensibility behind them which takes days to die away. As long as it lasts, those tracts or those modes are liable to have their activities awakened by causes which at other times might leave them in repose. Hence, recency in experience is a prime factor in determining revival in thought. Vividness in an original experience may also have the same effect as habit or recency in bringing about likelihood of revival. If we have once witnessed an execution, any subsequent conversation or reading about capital punishment will almost certainly suggest images of that particular scene. Thus it is that events lived through only once, and in youth, may come in after years, by reason of their exciting quality or emotional intensity, to serve as types or instances used by our mind to illustrate any and every occurring topic whose interest is most remotely pertinent to theirs. If a man in his boyhood once talked with Napoleon, any mention of great men or historical events, battles or thrones, or the whirligig of fortune, or islands in the ocean, will be apt to draw to his lips the incidents of that one memorable interview. If the word tooth now suddenly appears on the page before the reader's eye, there are 50 chances out of 100 that, if he gives it time to awaken any image, it will be an image of some operation of dentistry in which he has been the sufferer. Daily he has touched his teeth and masticated with them, this very morning he brushed them, chewed his breakfast and picked them, but the rarer and remoter associations arise more promptly because they were so much more intense. A fourth factor in tracing the course of reproduction is congruity in emotional tone between the reproduced idea and our mood. The same objects do not recall the same associates when we are cheerful as when we are melancholy. Nothing, in fact, is more striking than our utter inability to keep up trains of joyous imagery when we are depressed in spirits. Storm, darkness, war, images of disease, poverty, and perishing afflict unremittingly the imaginations of melancholiacs. And those of sanguine temperament, when their spirits are high, find it impossible to give any permanence to evil forebodings or to gloomy thoughts. In an instant the train of association dances off to flowers and sunshine, and images of spring and hope. The records of Arctic or African travel perused in one mood awaken no thoughts but those of horror at the malignity of nature, read at another time they suggest only enthusiastic reflections on the indomitable power and pluck of man. Few novels so overflow with joyous animal spirits as The Three Guardsmen of Dumas. Yet it may awaken in the mind of a reader depressed with seasickness, as the writer can personally testify, a most dismal and woeful consciousness of the cruelty and carnage of which heroes like Athos, Porthos, and Aramis make themselves guilty. Habit, recency, vividness, and emotional congruity are, then, all reasons why one representation rather than another should be awakened by the interesting portion of a departing thought. We may say with truth that in the majority of cases the coming representation will have been either habitual, recent, or vivid, and will be congruous. If all these qualities unite in any one absent associate, we may predict almost infallibly that that associate of the going thought will form an important ingredient in the coming thought. In spite of the fact, however, that the succession of representations is thus redeemed from perfect indeterminism and limited to a few classes whose characteristic quality is fixed by the nature of our past experience, it must still be confessed that an immense number of terms in the linked chain of our representations fall outside of all assignable rule. To take the instance of the clock given on page 586. Why did the jeweler's shop suggest the shirt studs rather than a chain which I had bought there more recently, which had cost more, and whose sentimental associations were much more interesting? Both chain and studs had excited brain tracks simultaneously with the shop. The only reason why the nerve stream from the shop tract switched off into the stud tract rather than into the chain tract must be that the stud tract happened at that moment to lie more open, either because of some accidental alteration in its nutrition or because the incipient subconscious tensions of the brain as a whole had so distributed their equilibrium that it was more unstable here than in the chain tract. Any reader's introspection will easily furnish similar instances. It thus remains true that to a certain extent, even in those forms of ordinary mixed association which lie nearest to impartial redintegration, which associate of the interesting item shall emerge must be called largely a matter of accident-accident, that is, for our intelligence. No doubt it is determined by cerebral causes, but they are too subtle and shifting for our analysis. Association by similarity. In partial or mixed association we have all along supposed the interesting portion of the disappearing thought to be of considerable extent, and to be sufficiently complex to constitute by itself a concrete object. Sir William Hamilton relates, for instance, that after thinking of Ben Lomond he found himself thinking of the Prussian system of education, and discovered that the links of association were a German gentleman whom he had met on Ben Lomond, Germany, etc. The interesting part of Ben Lomond, as he had experienced it, the part operative in determining the train of his ideas was the complex image of a particular man. But now let us suppose that that selective agency of interested attention, which may thus convert impartial redintegration into partial association, let us suppose that it refines itself still further and accentuates a portion of the passing thought, so small as to be no longer the image of a concrete thing, but only of an abstract quality or property. Let us moreover suppose that the part thus accentuated persists in consciousness, or, in cerebral terms, has its brain process continue, after the other portions of the thought have faded. This small surviving portion will then surround itself with its own associates after the fashion we have already seen, and the relation between the new thought's object and the object of the faded thought will be a relation of similarity. The pair of thoughts will form an instance of what is called association by similarity. The similars which are here associated, or of which the first is followed by the second in the mind, are seen to be compounds. Experience proves that this is always the case. There is no tendency on the part of simple ideas, attributes, or qualities to remind us of their like. The thought of one shade of blue does not remind us of that of another shade of blue, etc., unless indeed we have in mind some general purpose like naming the tint, when we should naturally think of other blues of the scale, through mixed association of purpose, names, and tints, together. But there is no elementary tendency of pure qualities to awaken their similars in the mind. We saw in the chapter 0 on discrimination that two compound things are similar when some one quality or group of qualities is shared alike by both, although as regards their other qualities they may have nothing in common. The moon is similar to a gas jet, it is also similar to a football, but a gas jet and a football are not similar to each other. When we affirm the similarity of two compound things, we should always say in what respect it obtains. Moon and gas jet are similar in respect of luminosity, and nothing else, moon and football in respect of rotundity, and nothing else. Football and gas jet are in no respect similar, that is, they possess no common point, no identical attribute. Similarity, in compounds, is partial identity. When the same attribute appears in two phenomena, though it be their only common property, the two phenomena are similar in so far forth. To return now to our associated representations. If the thought of the moon is succeeded by the thought of a football, and that by the thought of one of Mr. X's railroads, it is because the attribute rotundity in the moon broke away from all the rest and surrounded itself with an entirely new set of companions: elasticity, leathery integument, swift mobility in obedience to human caprice, etc., and because the last-named attribute in the football in turn broke away from its companions, and, itself persisting, surrounded itself with such new attributes as make up the notions of a railroad king, of a rising and falling stock market, and the like. The gradual passage from impartial redintegration to similar association through what we have called ordinary mixed association may be symbolized by diagrams. Figure 41 is impartial redintegration, figure 42 is mixed, and figure 43 similar association. A in each is the passing, B the coming thought. In impartial, all parts of A are equally operative in calling up B. In mixed, most parts of A are inert. The part M alone breaks out and awakens B. In similar, the focalized part M is much smaller than in the previous case, and after awakening its new set of associates, instead of fading out itself, it continues persistently active along with them, forming an identical part in the two ideas, and making these, pro tanto, resemble each other. Why a single portion of the passing thought should break out from its concert with the rest and act, as we say, on its own hook, why the other parts should become inert, are mysteries which we can ascertain but not explain. Possibly a minuter insight into the laws of neural action will someday clear the matter up, possibly neural laws will not suffice, and we shall need to invoke a dynamic reaction of the form of consciousness upon its content. But into this we cannot enter now. Asterisk, 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 asterisk. To sum up, then, we see that the difference between the three kinds of association reduces itself to a simple difference in the amount of that portion of the nerve tract supporting the going thought which is operative in calling up the thought which comes. But the modus operandi of this active part is the same, be it large or be it small. The items constituting the coming object waken in every instance because their nerve tracks once were excited continuously with those of the going object or its operative part. This ultimate physiological law of habit among the neural elements is what runs the train. The direction of its course and the form of its transitions, whether redintegrative, associative, or similar, are due to unknown regulative or determinative conditions which accomplish their effect by opening this switch and closing that, setting the engine sometimes at half speed, and coupling or uncoupling cars. This last figure of speech, into which I have glided unwittingly, affords itself an excellent instance of association by similarity. I was thinking of the deflections of the course of ideas. Now, from Hobbes's time downward, English writers have been fond of speaking of the train of our representations. This word happened to stand out in the midst of my complex thought with peculiarly sharp accentuation, and to surround itself with numerous details of railroad imagery. Only such details became clear, however, as had their nerve tracts besieged by a double set of influences, those from train on the one hand, and those from the movement of thought on the other. It may possibly be that the prepotency of the suggestions of the word train at this moment were due to the recent excitation of the railroad brain tract by the instance chosen a few pages back of two railroad kings playing football with the stock market. It is apparent from such an example how inextricably complex are all the contributory factors whose resultant is the line of our reverie. It would be folly in most cases to attempt to trace them out. From an instance like the above, where the pivot of the similar association was formed by a definite concrete word, train, to those where it is so subtle as utterly to elude our analysis, the passage is unbroken. We can form a series of examples. When Mr. Badgett says that the mind of the savage, so far from being in a state of nature, is tattooed all over with monstrous superstitions, the case is very like the one we have just been considering. When Sir James Stephen compares our belief in the uniformity of nature, the congruity of the future with the past, to a man rowing one way and looking another, and steering his boat by keeping her stern in a line with an object behind him, the operative link becomes harder to dissect out. It is subtler still in Dr. Holmes's phrase, that stories in passing from mouth to mouth make a great deal of leeway in proportion to their headway, or in Mr. Lowell's description of German sentences, that they have a way of yawing and going stern foremost and not minding the helm for several minutes after it has been put down. And finally, it is a real puzzle when the color pale blue is said to have feminine and blood-red masculine affinities. And if I hear a friend describe a certain family as having blotting paper voices, the image, though immediately felt to be apposite, baffles the utmost powers of analysis. The higher poets all use abrupt epithets, which are alike intimate and remote, and, as Emerson says, sweetly torment us with invitations to their inaccessible homes. In these latter instances, we must suppose that there is an identical portion in the similar objects, and that its brain tract is energetically operative, without, however, being sufficiently isolable in its activity as to stand out per se, and form the condition of a distinctly discriminated, abstract idea. We cannot even by careful search see the bridge over which we passed from the heart of one representation to that of the next. In some brains, however, this mode of transition is extremely common. It would be one of the most important of physiological discoveries could we assign the mechanical or chemical difference which makes the thoughts of one brain cling close to impartial redintegration, while those of another shoot about in all the lawless revelry of similarity. Why, in these latter brains, action should tend to focalize itself in small spots, while in the others it fills patiently its broad bed, it seems impossible to guess. Whatever the difference may be, it is what separates the man of genius from the prosaic creature of habit and routine thinking. In Chapter 0.xxii we shall need to recur again to this point. Association in voluntary thought. Hitherto we have assumed the process of suggestion of one object by another to be spontaneous. The train of imagery wanders at its own sweet will, now trudging in sober grooves of habit, now with a hop, skip, and jump darting across the whole field of time and space. This is reverie, or musing, but great segments of the flux of our ideas consist of something very different from this. They are guided by a distinct purpose or conscious interest. As the Germans say, we Nachdenken, or think towards a certain end. It is now necessary to examine what modification is made in the trains of our imagery by the having of an end in view. The course of our ideas is then called voluntary. Physiologically considered, we must suppose that a purpose means the persistent activity of certain rather definite brain processes throughout the whole course of thought. Our most usual cogitations are not pure reveries, absolute driftings, but revolve about some central interest or topic to which most of the images are relevant, and towards which we return promptly after occasional digressions. This interest is subserved by the persistently active brain tracts we have supposed. In the mixed associations which we have hitherto studied, the parts of each object which form the pivots on which our thoughts successively turn have their interest largely determined by their connection with some general interest which for the time has seized upon the mind. If we call Z the brain tract of general interest, then, if the object ABC turns up, and B has more associations with C than have either A or C, B will become the object's interesting, pivotal portion, and will call up its own associates exclusively. For the energy of B's brain tract will be augmented by Z's activity, an activity which, from lack of previous connection between Z and A or C, does not influence A or C. If, for instance, I think of Paris whilst I am hungry, I shall not improbably find that its restaurants have become the pivot of my thought, etc., etc. But in the theoretic as well as in the practical life there are interests of a more acute sort, taking the form of definite images of some achievement, be it action or acquisition, which we desire to effect. The train of ideas arising under the influence of such an interest constitutes usually the thought of the means by which the end shall be attained. If the end by its simple presence does not instantaneously suggest the means, the search for the latter becomes an intellectual problem. The solution of problems is the most characteristic and peculiar sort of voluntary thinking. Where the end thought of is some outward deed or gain, the solution is largely composed of the actual motor processes, walking, speaking, writing, etc., which lead up to it. Where the end is in the first instance only ideal, as in laying out a place of operations, the steps are purely imaginary. In both of these cases, the discovery of the means may form a new sort of end, of an entirely peculiar nature, an end, namely, which we intensely desire before we have attained it, but of the nature of which, even whilst most strongly craving it, we have no distinct imagination whatever. Such an end is a problem. The same state of things occurs whenever we seek to recall something forgotten, or to state the reason for a judgment which we have made intuitively. The desire strains and presses in a direction which it feels to be right but towards a point which it is unable to see. In short, the absence of an item is a determinant of our representations quite as positive as its presence can ever be. The gap becomes no mere void, but what is called an aching void. If we try to explain in terms of brain action how a thought which only potentially exists can yet be effective, we seem driven to believe that the brain tract thereof must actually be excited, but only in a minimal and subconscious way. Try, for instance, to symbolize what goes on in a man who is racking his brains to remember a thought which occurred to him last week. The associates of the thought are there, many of them at least, but they refuse to awaken the thought itself. We cannot suppose that they do not irradiate at all into its brain tract, because his mind quivers on the very edge of its recovery. Its actual rhythm sounds in his ears, the words seem on the imminent point of following, but fail. What it is that blocks the discharge and keeps the brain excitement here from passing beyond the nascent into the vivid state cannot be guessed. But we see in the philosophy of desire and pleasure, that such nascent excitements, spontaneously tending to a crescendo, but inhibited or checked by other causes, may become potent mental stimuli and determinants of desire. All questioning, wonder, emotion of curiosity, must be referred to cerebral causes of some such form as this. The great difference between the effort to recall things forgotten and the search after the means to a given end, is that the latter have not, whilst the former have, already formed a part of our experience. If we first study the mode of recalling a thing forgotten, we can take up with better understanding the voluntary quest of the unknown. The forgotten thing is felt by us as a gap in the midst of certain other things. If it is a thought, we possess a dim idea of where we were and what we were about when it occurred to us. We recollect the general subject to which it relates. But all these details refuse to shoot together into a solid whole, for the lack of the vivid traits of this missing thought, the relation whereof to each detail forms now the main interest of the latter. We keep running over the details in our mind, dissatisfied, craving something more. From each detail there radiate lines of association forming so many tentative guesses. Many of these are immediately seen to be irrelevant, are therefore void of interest, and lapse immediately from consciousness. Others are associated with the other details present, and with the missing thought as well. When these surge up, we have a peculiar feeling that we are warm, as the children say when they play hide and seek, and such associates as these we clutch at and keep before the attention. Thus we recollect successively that when we had the thought in question we were at the dinner table, then that our friend J.D. was there, then that the subject talked about was so and so, finally, that the thought came apropos of a certain anecdote, and then that it had something to do with a French quotation. Now all these added associations arise independently of the will, by the spontaneous process we know so well. All that the will does is to emphasize and linger over those which seem pertinent, and ignore the rest. Through this hovering of the attention in the neighborhood of the desired object, the accumulation of associates becomes so great that the combined tensions of their neural processes break through the bar, and the nervous wave pours into the tract which has so long been awaiting its advent. And as the expectant, subconscious itching there, bursts into the fullness of vivid feeling, the mind finds an inexpressible relief. The whole process can be rudely symbolized in a diagram. Call the forgotten thing Z, the first facts with which we felt it was related. A, B, and C, and the details finally operative in calling it up. L, M, and N. Each circle will then stand for the brain process underlying the thought of the object denoted by the letter contained within it. The activity in Z will at first be a mere tension, but as the activities in A, B, and C little by little irradiate into L, M, and N, and as all these processes are somehow connected with Z, their combined irradiations upon Z, represented by the centripetal arrows, succeed in helping the tension there to overcome the resistance, and in rousing Z also to full activity. The tension present from the first in Z, even though it keep below the threshold of discharge, is probably to some degree cooperative with A, B, C in determining that L, M, N shall awake. Without Z's tension there might be a slower accumulation of objects connected with it. But, as aforesaid, the objects come before us through the brain's own laws, and the ego of the thinker can only remain on hand, as it were, to recognize their relative values and brood over some of them, whilst others are let drop. As when we have lost a material object we cannot recover it by a direct effort, but only through moving about such neighborhoods wherein it is likely to lie, and trusting that it will then strike our eye, so here, by not letting our attention leave the neighborhood of what we seek, we trust that it will end by speaking to us of its own accord. Turn now to the case of finding the unknown means to a distinctly conceived end. The end here stands in the place of A, B, C, in the diagram. It is the starting point of the irradiations of suggestion, and here, as in that case, what the voluntary attention does is only to dismiss some of the suggestions as irrelevant, and hold fast to others which are felt to be more pertinent. Let these be symbolized by L, M, N. These latter at last accumulate sufficiently to discharge altogether into Z, the excitement of which process is, in the mental sphere, equivalent to the solution of our problem. The only difference between this case and the last is that in this one there need be no original sub-excitement in Z, cooperating from the very first. When we seek a forgotten name, we must suppose the name's center to be in a state of active tension from the very outset, because of that peculiar feeling of recognition which we get at the moment of recall. The plenitude of the thought seems here but a maximum degree of something which our mind divined in advance. It instantaneously fills a socket completely molded to its shape, and it seems most natural to ascribe the identity of quality in our feeling of the gaping socket and our feeling of what comes to fill it, to the sameness of a nerve tract excited in different degrees. In the solving of a problem, on the contrary, the recognition that we have found the means is much less immediate. Here, what we are aware of in advance seems to be its relations with the items we already know. It must bear a causal relation, or it must be an effect, or it must contain an attribute common to two items, or it must be a uniform concomitant, or what not. We know, in short, a lot about it, whilst as yet we have no knowledge of acquaintance with it, see page 221, or in Mr. Hodgson's language, we know what we want to find beforehand, in a certain sense, in its second intention, and do not know it, in another sense, in its first intention. Our intuition that one of the ideas which turn up is, at last, our quis item, is due to our recognition that its relations are identical with those we had in mind, and this may be a rather slow act of judgment. In fact, everyone knows that an object may be for some time present to his mind before its relations to other matters are perceived. To quote Hodgson again, the mode of operation is common to voluntary memory and reason. But reasoning adds to memory the function of comparing or judging the images which arise. Memory aims at filling the gap with an image which has at some particular time filled it before, reasoning with one which bears certain time and space relations to the images before and after, or, to use perhaps clearer language, one which stands in determinate logical relations to those data round about the gap which filled our mind at the start. This feeling of the blank form of relationship before we get the material quality of the thing related will surprise no one who has read Chapter 9. From the guessing of newspaper enigmas to the plotting of the policy of an empire, there is no other process than this. We trust to the laws of cerebral nature to present us spontaneously with the appropriate idea. Our only command over it is by the effort we make to keep the painful unfilled gap in consciousness. Two circumstances are important to notice. The first is, that volition has no power of calling up images, but only of rejecting and selecting from those offered by spontaneous redintegration. But the rapidity with which this selection is made, owing to the familiarity of the ways in which spontaneous redintegration runs, gives the process of reasoning the appearance of evoking images that are foreseen to be conformable to the purpose. There is no seeing them before they are offered, there is no summoning them before they are seen. The other circumstance is that every kind of reasoning is nothing, in its simplest form, but attention. It is foreign to our purpose here to enter into any detailed analysis of the different classes of mental pursuit. In a scientific research, we get perhaps as rich an example as can be found. The inquirer starts with a fact of which he seeks the reason, or with an hypothesis of which he seeks the proof. In either case, he keeps turning the matter incessantly in his mind until, by the arousal of associate upon associate, some habitual, some similar, one arises which he recognizes to suit his need. This, however, may take years. No rules can be given by which the investigator may proceed straight to his result, but both here and in the case of reminiscence, the accumulation of helps in the way of associations may advance more rapidly by the use of certain routine methods. In striving to recall a thought, for example, we may have set purpose run through the successive classes of circumstance with which it may possibly have been connected, trusting that when the right member of the class has turned up, it will help the thought's revival. Thus we may run through all the places in which we may have had it. We may run through the persons whom we remember to have conversed with, or we may call up successively all the books we have lately been reading. If we are trying to remember a person, we may run through a list of streets or of professions. Some item out of the lists thus methodically gone over will very likely be associated with the fact we are in need of, and may suggest it or help to do so. And yet the item might never have arisen without such systematic procedure. In scientific research, this accumulation of associates has been methodized by Mill under the title of The Four Methods of Experimental Inquiry. By the method of agreement, by that of difference, by those of residues and concomitant variations, which cannot here be more nearly defined, we make certain lists of cases, and by ruminating these lists in our minds, the cause we seek will be more likely to emerge. But the final stroke of discovery is only prepared, not effected, by them. The brain tracks must, of their own accord, shoot the right way at last, or we shall still grope in darkness. That in some brains the tracks do shoot the right way much oftener than in others, and that we cannot tell why, these are ultimate facts to which we must never close our eyes. Even in forming our lists of instances according to Mill's methods, we are at the mercy of the spontaneous workings of similarity in our brain. How are a number of facts, resembling the one whose cause we seek, to be brought together in a list unless the one will rapidly suggest the other through association by similarity? Similarity, no elementary law. Such is the analysis I propose, first of the three main types of spontaneous association, and then of voluntary association. It will be observed that the object called up may bear any logical relation whatever to the one which suggested it. The law requires only that one condition should be fulfilled. The fading object must be due to a brain process, some of whose elements awaken through habit, some of the elements of the brain process of the object which comes to view. This awakening is the operative machinery, the causal agency, throughout, quite as much so in the kind of association I have called by the name of similarity, as in any other sort. The similarity between the objects, or between the thoughts, if similarity there be between these latter, has no causal agency in carrying us from one to the other. It is but a result the effect of the usual causal agent when this happens to work in a certain particular and assignable way. But ordinary writers talk as if the similarity of the objects were itself an agent, coordinate with habit, and independent of it, and like it able to push objects before the mind. This is quite unintelligible. The similarity of two things does not exist till both things are there. It is meaningless to talk of it as an agent of production of anything, whether in the physical or the psychical realms. It is a relation which the mind perceives after the fact, just as it may perceive the relations of superiority, of distance, of causality, of container and content, of substance and accident, or of contrast, between an object and some second object which the associative machinery calls up. There are, nevertheless, able writers who not only insist on preserving association by similarity as a distinct elementary law, but who make it the most elementary law, and seek to derive contiguous association from it. Their reasoning is as follows: when the present impression A awakens the idea B of its past contiguous associate B, how can this occur except through first reviving an image of its own past occurrence? This is the term directly connected with B, so that the process instead of being simply A, B is A, A, B. Now A and A are similars, therefore no association by contiguity can occur except through a previous association by similarity. The most important supposition here made is that every impression on entering the mind must needs awaken an image of its past self, in the light of which it is apperceived or understood, and through the intermediation of which it enters into relation with the mind's other objects.